Students, let's today talk about chapter 15, biodiversity and conservation. Now, what is biodiversity? Biodiversity is the variety of living organisms on earth and how many they are. So suppose if we try to measure this, so there are around 3 lakh species of beetle, 20,000 ants, 28,000 fishes, this is a species, and 20,000 orchids. Orchids are the flowering plants. So this is the variety of living organisms. We're talking about the species number. So when we talk about biodiversity here, so most of the time I'll be talking about the species number. So it was Edward Wilson who described combined diversity at all levels of biological organization. So what are the different levels of biological levels of biodiversity? There could be genetic diversity, there could be species diversity, and there could be ecological biodiversity. Let's talk about genetic biodiversity. So genetic diversity means diversity within a single species. And suppose if you take an example of Rau Wolfia vomitoria, which is a medicinal plant found in Himalayas. So if there are different types of plants within the species, so if I want to know variety of them, the differences in them, so what I'll be doing is I'll be talking in terms of potency and concentration of active ingredient. And the chemical that is active ingredient is the reserpine, which is medicinal chemical. And India has 50,000 genetically different strains of rice and 1,000 that of varieties of mango. So this has to be within the species. And we have around 21,000 of that of wheat. So within a species, if there is a variety, and that is basically what we call as a genetic biodiversity. At species level, let us see what is biodiversity meaning. At species level means ki there are different types of species and how they are different. Suppose if we talk about Rau Wolfia only, as I have taken the example in the above paragraph, there are two varieties, Rau Wolfia vomitoria, and there is another one called the Rau Wolfia serpentina. Now if we have differences between the two, so then this becomes a species biodiversity. Similarly, another example is that the western ghats, they have greater amphibian species biodiversity than the eastern ghats. So we have more number of species on the western ghats of India than on the eastern ghat, because of the obvious reason that the western ghats, they receive more of the rain. Then there is, at a wider scale if you see, there is ecological diversity, and at the ecosystem level. For example, the desert ecosystem, rainforest, mangroves, coral reefs, wetlands, estuaries, and even alpine meadows. Alpine meadow means I'm talking about the grasslands in the on the hills. As a greater ecosystem diversity than a Scandinavian country like Norway. Scandinavian countries are the countries on the extreme north. Towards the North Pole, there are Sweden, Finland, Holland type of, and Norway type of countries. They're called Scandinavian because their conditions are not suitable, so there are lesser diversity as if we talk about the other areas. Now this biodiversity must have evolved after a millions of long time period, that is millions of years. Now let's see how many different types of species are there on the earth and how to measure the number of, how to calculate this number of species, or who must have calculated all this. So it was Robert May who for the first time gave this data that there are about 7 million species diversity, 7 million number of species on earth. And out of this, 1.5 million they have been described so far. Now how to calculate the number of species? For this, what the biologists do, they make a statistical comparison of the temperate and tropical species richness. And for that, they'll be studying exhaustively the most widest biodiversified organism, that is insects, and then they extrapolate this with other total number of species on earth with other groups. So how to calculate the total number of species on earth? So what the biologists do, they make a statistical comparison of the temperate tropical species richness of an exhaustively studied group like insects, and then they extrapolate this ratio with the other group of organisms, plants and animals. And extrapolate means they estimate the value or compute the value of other organisms as in comparison to the insects. So it is basically the insects to be studied first, because they are the most biodiversified, and then they are related with the other species. Then students, with respect to board exams, this diagram is again very important, this chart, pie chart. Let's see what is given here. So as we study the biodiversity on earth, what we find is there are some data that the animals, they are the most biodiversified. Almost 70% of them, they are the animals, and out of that 70% are insects. So it's the arthropods most biodiversified, and among that also there are insects more, and plants are only 22% of variety of species, number of species. Yeah, among the animals, it is the insects most biodiversified, then comes the mollusks, and then the others. So you can study these two pie charts. So among the invertebrates, it is the insects most, then the mollusks. So you can put numbering here 1, 2, and then the others. Similarly, among the vertebrates, it is the fishes most biodiversified, then the birds, then the reptiles, amphibians, and then the mammals. So you need to know the sequence of the diversity. And among the plants, it is the angiosperms most biodiversified, then the fungi, they are included in plants previously, then the algae, then the mosses, ferns, and the lichens. Now among all this, we have not described the biodiversity at prokaryotes, at the prokaryotes level. So why this is not, we have not been able to do that? Because there is a problem with the conventional method. We cannot identify the microbes, and many of them, they cannot be cultured or grown in laboratory conditions. So we have to go for a biochemical or molecular criteria for counting the number of species. Molecular criteria means I'm talking about the DNA and RNA level, so that we can calculate the number of different types of prokaryotes, and we never know, the diversity may run into millions. Now if we talk about India is 2.4% of the total world's land, but we have 8.1% of the total biodiversity. In fact, we are one of the 12th most mega diversified country in the world. Let's talk about the patterns of biodiversity, how biodiversity varies. Now how it varies with latitudes. What are latitudes? Latitudes are these parallel lines along the equator, and as we move from equator towards the north or the south pole, biodiversity tends to decrease. Let's take some examples for this. Now the first example is the country Colombia. Colombia is here, some almost at equator, and this has around 1400 species of birds. But suppose if we talk about New York, here this is quite away from equator, so it has only 105 species of birds. And if we talk about Greenland further north, so there will be only some 56 species of birds. And if we talk about India, which is somewhere in the subtropics, so there are only about 1200 species of birds. Suppose we talk about the Amazons, this region almost on the equator, this has more than 40,000 species of plants, 3,000 species of fishes, 1300 species of birds, 427 species of mammals, 378 species of reptiles, and around 125,000 species of invertebrates. Now let's see why the Amazons or equator is so much rich in biodiversity. So there are three reasons as per your book. The first is that speciation is generally a function of time, and unlike temperate regions subjected to frequent glaciations in the past, tropical latitudes have remained relatively undisturbed for many of the years, and thus had a long time for evolution of various species and their diversification. The first reason is speciation, that the species got the time to diversify. Then the second reason is the tropical environment, like unlike temperate ones. Temperate means I'm talking about the colder environment conditions. They're less seasonal, relatively more constant and predictable. So there is niche specialization. And the third is there is a specialization, and that leads to greater species biodiversity. Then the third is, there is more solar energy available in the tropics, which contributes to the higher productivity. So basically there are three reasons. First is speciation, second is niche specialization, and the third is higher productivity, because there is intense sunlight all through the year. So these are the three basic reasons why tropics are supposed to be more biodiversified. Let's see how the species varies with area. So it was Alexander von Humboldt who explored the South American jungles, and what he found was that if we keep on increasing the area explored, if we increase the area explored, the species richness is increasing, but up to some extent only. Then beyond that, it becomes constant. So we get a hyperbola, rectangular hyperbola for this. And on a log-log scale, suppose we convert this equation, S is equal to CAZ into a log-log scale. So what we get is log S is equal to log C plus Z log A, where S is the species richness, A is the area, Z is the slope of line, the regression coefficient, and C is the y-intercept. Now what is this Z, which is the most important thing here? Slope of line, this slope. Now suppose the slope becomes this is shifted towards the left, so that means there will be lesser area and more biodiversity. But if this becomes, if the slope is reduced, or this log-log scale line moves towards the right, so that will be meaning that the more the area covered, lesser will be the biodiversity. So this basically gives the idea about the biodiversity in an area. Now this Z, the slope of the line, has to be between 0.1 to 0.2, regardless of whatever is the taxonomic group or the region. But suppose if you are talking about a larger area, so the Z becomes more steeper, and the Z value becomes 0.62, that may range between 0.6 to 1.2. For example, the frugivores, the fruit-eating birds in the tropical forests of different continents, for this the slope is 1.15. Okay, let's see the importance of species diversity for an ecosystem. Now, there was a scientist, Tillman. What he found was that the stable communities should not show too much of variation in productivity from year to year. That means more diversified an ecosystem is, more stable will be the ecosystems. And second thing is that there will be more productivity. And the third thing is that there will be more the biodiversity, there will be more chances of other species survival. In fact, that will be affecting human race also. Now there is a very important analog that has been given in this next paragraph. Here it was Paul Ehrlich, a Stanford ecologist, who gave this analog. And according to him, let us see how loss of a species may affect us. So what was the analog? That he considered aeroplane as an ecosystem, and all the rivets which are needed to join the various parts of the aeroplane are called the rivets, suppose, if you consider that to be the rivets. And suppose a passenger traveling in it starts popping the rivets, and suppose if the rivet is from the seat, so that may not cause much of the harm. But suppose if we take out the rivet from the engine or from the wings, so that may lead to major problem to the aeroplane or the flight. So similarly, if there is a species which is less important in the ecosystem, and if it is extinct, so that may not cause that much visible harm to the ecosystem. But suppose if it is a keystone species, I'm using a word, keystone species. Keystone species is a species which affects, whose presence affects a large number of other species. So if a keystone species is affected or it gets extinct, so then this will be leading to the loss of various other number of species. So a species, if it is more important one, and if it is extinct, so that may lead to more of the problem and directly may affect many other species. Let's talk about the loss of biodiversity. So in the recent past, because of the colonization of tropical Pacific islands by humans, there is around 2,000 species of native birds that have been lost. And as per the IUCN Red List, what is IUCN? It is the International Union for Conservation of Nature. IUCN, it prepares a red list where we have different categories like the extinct category, critically endangered, endangered, vulnerable, threatened, and some examples of recent extinctions include the dodo bird from Mauritius, quagga from Africa, thylacine from Australia, Steller's sea cow from Russia, and three subspecies, Bali Javan and Caspian tiger. Let's see what they are. So let me show you some species. Now this is the quagga, the zebra kind of animal, is extinct. Thylacine is a kind of a fox. This is another one, that is the, we can say it is mammoth, the ancestor of our modern elephants. And this one is dodo, Tasmanian wolf, passenger pigeon. This is dodo. Let's see the causes of biodiversity losses. In fact, there are four basic causes and they are called the evil quartet. And the most important one is the habitat loss and fragmentation, where we are destroying the habitat of the organism or the species, and because of that the organism is getting extinct. For example, let's take an example, the tropics used to cover 14% of Earth's land surface sometimes, but now there are only 6% left and they are destroyed at a very fast rate. And there are many species which are getting lost in the tropics. In fact, the Amazon rainforest, which are very huge and they're called the lungs of planet Earth, they were harboring millions of species, but now they are being cut and cleared for soybean or for conversion of grasslands for raising beef. And this loss is leading to the loss of many of the species. And they are basically the higher trophic level species, like the mammals or the birds. The second reason is the overexploitation. You know, human need turns into greed, and that has led to loss of some certain species like the Steller's sea cow and the passenger pigeon. Many marine fish populations around the world are being harvested, endangered, and they're getting lost. Then there is some alien species invasions. For example, we are introducing some other species, some alien species into a local habitat, and then they are getting invasive. For example, the Nile perch, when introduced into Lake Victoria in the East Africa, led to extinction of an ecologically unique assemblage of more than 200 species of the chitlid fish in the lake. Similarly, the carrot grass, the parthenium, and the lantana, and the water hyacinth acornia, when introduced in India, they're causing problems. They're getting invasive, in fact. Introduction of African catfish, Clarius gerripenis, for aquaculture purposes, is posing a threat to the indigenous catfishes in India. They're also called Clarius only. The fourth reason is the co-extinction. Co-extinction means, suppose one of the species is lost and the other species is dependent on that, so this also tend to get lost. For example, the plant and the pollinator, where the relationship like mutualism is involved. Or suppose the parasitism is involved. So such species, they tend to get extinct together. Now, why certain species is more susceptible to extinction? So there could be again four or five reasons. Like the first is the large body size, like the Bengal tiger, lion, elephant. Then there could be small population size and the low reproductive rate, for example the blue whale and the giant panda. Or the organisms they are feeding at high trophic levels, like the Bengal tiger and the bald eagle. Or they have a fixed migratory routes and behavior, like the blue whale and the whooping crane. Or they are localized in narrow range of distribution, like the woodland caribou and the island species. So it's our moral duty to conserve biodiversity. But how do we conserve biodiversity? So there are two basic ways. One is called in situ conservation and the other is called ex situ. In situ means within the natural environment, and ex situ means in vitro, outside the natural environment. Let's see what are the ways of in situ conservation. For in situ conservation, there could be some biodiversity hotspots. Now these are the regions with high level of species richness and high level of endemism. Endemism means the species, they are confined to a local area only, and therefore it's very important to save them. Initially there were 25 such biodiversity hotspots, but now there are 34. Now, these are the reasons of accelerated habitat loss. Three of these hotspots, Western Ghats, Sri Lanka, Indo-Burma, Himalaya, are there in our country only. Then the other ways could be creation of the sacred groves, sacred lakes, biosphere reserves, national parks, wildlife sanctuaries. And the ex-situ ways could be sacred plants. We can grow them in the home garden. There could be seed banks, field gene banks, cryopreservation. Cryopreservation is a low temperature preservation. Or there could be botanical gardens, arboreta, zoo and aquaria. Now within the in-situ ways of conservation, there are very important are the sacred groves. Such sacred groves are basically taken care of by the local people as well as the government. And some such examples are the Khasi and Jaintia hills of Meghalaya, Aravali hills of Rajasthan, Western Ghat regions of Karnataka and Maharashtra, and the Sarguja, Chanda and the Bastar areas of Madhya Pradesh. In Meghalaya, the sacred groves are the last refugees of for a large number of rare and threatened plants. They're endemic plants. Now, what are the ex-situ ways? Ex-situ ways, like I told you, there would be zoological parks, botanical gardens, wildlife safari parks, or there could be some zoo zoological parks, or there could be some gene banks or the field banks. They could be created to conserve plants. Cryopreservation is very important one. Cryopreservation. This means that there could be certain things which could be dried and preserved. They could be kept at minus 196 degrees centigrade, that is in liquid nitrogen. For example, the germplasm, the DNA, this kind of thing. Now, what we are doing at the global level, how to conserve biodiversity and what to do? So there was an Earth Summit held in Rio de Janeiro in 1992, which called upon all the nations to take appropriate measures for conservation of biodiversity and sustainable utilization of its benefit. And similarly, there was a World Summit on Sustainable Development held in 2002 in Johannesburg, South Africa, where almost 190 countries they pledged and to achieve by 2010 a significant reduction in the current rate of biodiversity loss.